end your call.
Hello. Hello, students. This will be your 2-minute warning to please get settled. 2 minutes. Well,
they're too bright right now. Yeah, bring them down. I would still like a little light on, but right now it is, I don't know. Auditorium and out in the hallway. So we'd like to get started. So students and community members, if you would direct your attention up to the front stage. That's great. In a moment, I'm going to turn it over to our student leaders of youth and government at Waubonsie Valley, Neuqua Valley, and Matea Valley. You may or may not know that all three of our Valley schools are leaders in that youth and government program, and we're certainly very proud of it. My name is Chris Wolak. I'm the head advisor for youth and government at Waubonsie Valley. I would also like to personally thank my good friend and former Waubonsie Valley teacher eons ago, Andy Kinnean. He is our Mikva suburban coordinator. He's who you can thank for the pizza tonight, as they supported for that. The Mikva Network believes that democracy is a verb, and I know if you've seen Mrs. Fuhrer at Matea, Ms. Tufo at Neuqua, or myself wearing these shirts that say democracy is a verb, we strongly believe that your student-citizen engagement is key. Action civics, which is now a law in Illinois, thanks to many of the work of Waubonsie, Neuqua, and Matea students, as well as many other students who are part of the Mikva Network and not in a 204 school. Do we have any of them here today? Or not. But that's great. We have a lot of different events coming up in the campaign season. So without any further ado, I'm going to turn it over to our student leaders who are going to run the show today and explain you how everything's going. So As I look to my right, Dar, and then you can take it and introduce, and you guys run the show. If you guys would all introduce yourselves before we start.
We'd like to take a moment to thank you all for coming today, to thank Mikva for putting on this event, to thank Ms. Fuhr, Mr. Gregory, Ms. Tufo, and of course, Mr. Wolak for organizing this event as well, and again, for all of you for coming out today. So, good evening, I'm Nicole Chung, again, from Waubonsie Valley, and we are from YMCA Youth in Government, which is a program that exists at all three of our schools, and we are proud to be co-sponsoring the Mikva Challenge 2016 Candidate Forum tonight.
We would also like to welcome other community members that have come out to get more informed about our upcoming election.
Before we begin tonight, we'd like to invite Gerard Sweeney to lead us in the pledge.
Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Many of us are following this unique 2016 presidential campaign very closely. And some of us have registered to vote for this first time either last week at school sites at National Voter Registration Day or tonight. Thank you to the League of Women Voters of Naperville outside in our campaign fair. Make some noise if you actually got a chance to cast your first general election vote in November this year. Awesome. Okay. But even if you can't vote in November, this night is meant to give you an opportunity to connect with your favorite campaign, so that you can volunteer some time helping your favorite candidates win the power to govern and represent your voice in our republic. We hope you took advantage to talk to the campaigns during our campaign fair outside the auditorium, and hopefully you got some pizza. Compliments of the Mikva Challenge.
We want to thank our candidates for spending time with us tonight and to remind the audience that tonight's event is like a classroom. While students might be in charge of this classroom, we still have the rule of asking you to be respectful to all of our candidates. Please withhold any applause until the end of their speaking time. Our questions have been written by students from the Mikva Challenge. If you would still like to submit a question, you can do so on Twitter using the hashtag MikvaForum16. Tonight we'll hear from DuPage County Board Member Janice Anderson, Green Party candidate Tim Curtin for Illinois Comptroller, and Scott Summers for U.S. Senate. Candidate for U.S. Congressman and current DuPage County Board Member Tonia Khouri, the campaign of Congressman Bill Foster, Libertarian candidates Claire Ball for Illinois Comptroller, and Kent McMillen for U.S. Senate. U.S. Representative and the two candidates running for the Illinois 84th District Representative seat, Representative Stephanie Kifowit and challenger Mike Strick. The format for tonight's candidate forum is that each congressional candidate will get 5 minutes to speak to our audience and then 10 minutes to answer questions. As we are excited to have our candidates from both the Green Party and the Libertarian Party for the first time, those two candidates of each third party will share the stage at the same time. Questions are not directed toward any specific candidate. Questions have been categorized into two types. PBS questions are straightforward policy questions. HBO questions are a bit edgier questions. Candidates will have 90 seconds to answer these questions.
O, our timer over here, will indicate when you have 10 seconds remaining with a yellow card and will indicate when the time of your question has expired with a red card. Candidates can answer as many questions in any combination during their time. We'll reserve 1 minute at the end of their time to allow each candidate to close with a final appeal for student campaign volunteers.
With that being said, we welcome Janice Anderson, a DuPage County Board candidate who will help get going with the Chris Matthews motto, that all politics is local, and the importance of local government.
Hi. This is really something because I can't see you guys. This is weird. Usually, so I am a candidate for the DuPage County Board. I currently serve as a Naperville Township Trustee. I was elected in 2013, and I ran on a local government platform. And we ran to do things better, to do things more efficient. One of my platforms here, a little some signs, is about yes for lower taxes. We need to do a better job as elected officials in promoting, making sure our governments run efficiently. And that can be done at the local level. For instance, we're in a battle right now where the road commissioner is not very efficient with his budget. Well, if you were at home and your parents said you get so much money but you can't live on that, what would you do? You try to be more efficient with your money and try to save some money. So we really try to focus on doing the best for the taxpayers. So that's one of the main reasons I'm running for county board. So this is my sign for the county board. You may see it out there in the neighborhoods now. But I'm running for that reason, to really increase my focus on making governments more efficient. And I want to take that to the county level and do more with that. So I've been active since I was in high school. I grew up in Bolingbrook. And I've always been active in politics. I went to work for Governor Thompson back in the 80s. And I had a great time with that. And it was always fun to be involved. I met President Reagan at Bolingbrook High School when I was in high school. He came to our school. So I hope one of the presidential candidates will still make a plea and come to one of the District 204 schools. It'd be very exciting. So anyway, questions?
Would you like to start with a PBS question or an HBO question?
No, go with the HBO question.
No. Okay, let's see. What would you say to Martin Luther King Jr. if he was still alive?
Well, that'd be really impressive. He was such a good man that he really focused on doing what's right, and that's what I believe all the government officials should focus on. Although I do believe we all in our own mind try to do what's right, I really think it comes down to working with people, collaborating, and seeking out people's opinions. We always don't have to agree on whether it's, you know, liberal, conservative. I heard a lot of those words out there tonight asking where we stand in the political scheme of things. But I think that's really important, just to come together and find collaboration and find things together that we can work on. So that's what I would talk to him about.
Okay, PBS question.
Okay.
That's a weird question. As Illinois' financial crisis continues, Illinois public schools have been forced to raise tuition and lay off staff, among other cost-saving measures. Name one thing you would do if elected to support Illinois institutions of higher education while also seeking a solution to the state's budget problems.
Well, being that the county board doesn't focus on those plans, but using the philosophy, if I were elected in that other capacity, would be, again, trying to control the budget, working to live within their means, focusing on, again, doing the right thing. But I'm a big believer in making government efficient, cost sharing, bringing other governments together. For instance, you have a township, you have a county, there's all these kind of services that the state and the other local governments promote. Maybe we should come together and do those together. Call economies of scale. You may have learned that in some of your math and finance classes. So it's important to do more with less and come together. And sometimes you step on toes doing that, but I really think it's important that we look to the bigger picture, because if we don't make those changes to help higher education and have good schools here in Illinois, good higher education schools, the universities and college system, you kids aren't going to come back when you graduate. You're going to go off to Texas or Florida or other states. You're not coming home here. And maybe that sounds good right now, but Chicago's a great place to live and work and raise a family. And I do hope you'll come back to DuPage County and Kane County and our collar counties. And we as elected officials and many of us here need to do that for you. It's not about us. We've had our time. We need to do it for you so you can come home. Well, it would have to be Ronald Reagan. I met him once, and I miss him more every day because I just think he was a good person who believed in the right things and communicated with people, collaborated, and did the right thing. He was spot on the economy, and it's about making sure people have opportunity, and that's all I want for our state and for our county is jobs, so work. And earn their living, and everything takes care of from there, and then it enables you to get a good education. So it would be Ronald Reagan.
Ms. Anderson, what is your stance on the protection of students' freedom of speech outside of school online?
That's a tough one, because you have to be safe, and I think it's a matter of being smart when you're online. And, you know, we all say Facebook is good or bad. It can get us into trouble. But the point is just be safe. And But I always will err on the side of freedom of speech.
Ms. Anderson, what would be one thing you'd like to say to an undecided voter?
I'm sorry, say that again.
What would be one thing you'd like to say to an undecided voter?
Well, it's that I do my homework. I have focused on preparing for this, for running for the county board and hopefully serving on the county board. One of the main things about me is I work hard, I show up, I attend the meetings, and I show up on time. What happens to all of you if you go to your jobs and you don't show up on time? You get fired, and that's what I think we should do to my opponent. Because he is not showing up and being present and representing you, the people, and the voters on that county board district. Our county board district, County Board 5, which is Naperville, Aurora, and Lyle, needs representation, needs input. And that there's three county board members. And we're missing one because he chooses not to participate many times. And he's also not active in the community. And I'm sure all of you are active in many different volunteer items, from Loaves and Fishes to Hesed House, as well. And my opponent doesn't participate in the community.
You have 1 minute for a closing statement.
Well, thank you for allowing me to speak. And this is still kind of new to me, my first time running for a major office. So I apologize if I'm a little nervous, but it was a lot of fun, and I look forward to doing it again. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Anderson, and good luck. Next, we have our two Green Party candidates, Tim Curtin for Illinois Comptroller and Scott Summers for U.S. Senate. Mr. Curtin, could you please explain to the audience the role of the Comptroller in Illinois? And Mr.
Boy.
Summers, if you could introduce us to the Green Party in your opening remarks, that would be great.
Yes, my name is Tim Curtin, and I can't see anybody either. But the comptroller's office, the comptroller is the chief financial officer of the state of Illinois. What that means is this is the person that looks out over the budget. So I am running to fill a vacancy. Judy Bart Topinka died while in office, so there's a two-year vacancy in the office. So.
Generations have gone before us, all wanting the same thing, action. That is the case of each generation. They capitalize on their opportunities as best as they are able. But I think it's amplified for people like you, students of today. Let me put it this way. I do want the best for you, and the way I think it can be best expressed is with a little bit of water. There's an ancient prophecy I'd like to share with you, and it goes something like this. There will come a time when justice flows down like water, and righteousness will be an everlasting stream. And this is very important. I'm remembering now the remark I wanted to make. It's about climate. All the generations that have gone before us have not had to worry about climate. We do. And I have a little bit of an idea of what is going to befall us as a world and what will befall us as a nation. The Great Lakes Basin is going to become a lifeboat for humanity in 30, 40, 50 years. People will be coming here from all over the world. Why is that? Because we're 700 feet above sea level, we've got fresh water, we've got stable government. We have to plan and prepare for that eventuality. I think it will come to pass. And I commend you all again. Thank you so much.
All right. First of all, I would like to thank this forum for inviting all of us. I think it's a way where you get a chance to hear from candidates of all political persuasion. You get an opportunity to ask questions and get answers. And what I believe is that with the Green Party, we are about building grassroots democracy. So let me tell you why I'm running. I am running because I think the two major parties in Springfield have utterly failed the people of our state. They call it pay for play state. It's all about money and politics. As the wannabe chief financial officer, people should know that both parties have refused to balance a budget. They're actually in violation of our state constitution for over a year. They have cut funding for public education. We're already 50 out of 50 states, and they've cut it further. Now, what happens is that creates a burden on homeowners because most public education is funded by property taxes. So people that own homes, they are paying more. Seniors are losing their homes because they can no longer afford to stay in them. That's wrong and we need to change it. The other thing that the people in Springfield have done is they have made draconian cuts in social services. It's outrageous. I'll give you an example. Lutheran Social Services, it's a huge agency. They served 700,000 people last year. They're basically out of business. They handled help for the indigent, seniors without money, mentally challenged people. What's happened is the state of Illinois has refused to reimburse Lutheran Social Services, so they're basically out of business. So we need to change the basic politics. The state's heavily in debt. The two major parties refuse to talk about it. We cut taxes by $4.8 billion in 2015, so we're heavily in debt. Those two parties are afraid to talk about it because it's pay for play. Thank you.
The questions are open to both of you. Would you like to start with a PBS or HBO question?
All right, PBS it is. With many schools beginning to implement more technology in the classroom, what are your thoughts about schools becoming more digital?
Education is changing very profoundly before our eyes. There is no turning back on digitalization. That's one of the promises I spoke of, promise and peril before. Education education is going to change so rapidly. There is a futurist who forecasts that 50% of all the colleges and universities in the nation will be boarded up, lights out, by the year 2030. Bricks and mortar will never go away, but digitalization is here to stay. And we have to prepare for a new future in education that embraces the great new technologies that are before us, but at the same time, keeps us together as a society and a social network. We cannot succeed without bricks and mortar. We cannot succeed as a society if everybody's digitized and sits behind a monitor all day. That's not the way a society grows. But we are now seeing and will continue to see monumental changes in education.
You pick. It doesn't matter to me.
Many high school students feel they can't relate to what's going on in politics and that their voice doesn't truly matter. What do you say to that group of people?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear it.
Many high school students feel that they can't relate to what is going on in politics and that their voice doesn't matter. What do you want to say to that group of people?
Well, that's a great question. I think this forum is the beginning of it. Unfortunately, the two major parties don't really come out and talk to the public. They hide behind the media and they buy ads. The way I look at it, every person in here has an absolute right to make up their own mind. That's what democracy is supposed to be about. So I would say to all the students that are here, listen, learn, decide for yourself. That's what democracy is supposed to be about.
This is a more international question, trade-based question. Do you believe in free trade? And if so, what are your thoughts on the TPP deal?
Conceptually, free trade is a good idea. But the way it's being implemented, proposed and implemented, is entirely wrong. We've seen all the dysfunction with NAFTA. We're continuing to see new dysfunction with the Trans-Pacific Partnership. I'm adamantly opposed. First of all, actually two first of alls, I guess. One is the environmental aspect of the TPP. It is not at all addressed. Here in this era of climate change, as I was mentioning, we do have to have a plan as we trade among ourselves for climate change. The other is it is totally silent on labor. This was all written behind closed doors. Congress has an up and down vote on the issue. We have not as a society to participate. Congress has abdicated its role by having agreed to an up or down vote. The whole point of having a democracy is to air the issues out. And cutting it off by way of up and down vote is entirely wrong. In terms of NAFTA, consider some of the things that happened as a result of that. I'll give you an example of corn farmers. The first half of free trade, or fair trade, worked out very well, and that was U.S. corn went to Mexico at a price less than what the Mexicans were paying. But the unintended consequence, which went totally unaddressed, and still is unaddressed to this day, is all sorts, hundreds of thousands of Mexican farmers were forced off their land, and they were unemployed. The European Union has a provision for labor to migrate across borders, not NAFTA, and that is part of why we have the immigration problem that we see. People were thrown out of work by NAFTA, and they're coming to this country. If we were thoughtful enough to help people stay at home, stay on their farms, we would not have this immigration pressure. People who are immigrating from Mexico do not want to have to cross one of the worst deserts in the world. I think we need to renegotiate NAFTA. I think we need to disapprove the TPP.
All right, you both have 1 minute for a closing statement.
All right. Again, thank you for inviting us. Now, the Green Party, we believe in building democracy. Now, some people may say, well, why vote for a Green? You're not going to get elected. I may have to pick for the lesser of the two evils. Okay. What we say is this, if you go for the lesser of the two evils, you're still going to get some evil. We believe that you ought to vote this time for the greater good. Help us build democracy from the bottom up. So thank you very much.
Giving subsidies to people who don't need them or deserve them. And we are also wasting tax money by way of the interest on our atrocious national debt. Our tax policy is backwards. We need to raise up people. And that is the fulcrum for democracy, ladies and gentlemen. It's money. For all of our high ideals, it's money. And when you get into policy making, that is the fulcrum. That is where decisions are made. We need to turn it around so that people who are homeless, people who are sick, people who lack food, education, we need to bring them up beyond the poverty level. We are all equal. That is what Thomas Jefferson provided for us. We must make one another equal. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you to our Green Party candidates. Students in the audience, we just want to remind you, please be submitting things on the hashtag Mikva, it's M-I-K-V-A Forum 16. Comments, questions, just to get a social media presence would be a great addition to the evening.
Next, we have current DuPage County Board Member and candidate for the U.S. Congress 11th District Representative, Ms. Tonia.
Good evening. Hello, 204 seniors. Thank you so much for being here. My name is Tonia Khouri. I'm the congressional candidate for the 11th District. And if you'll indulge me, I do need to give a shout out to one of my favorite people, my son, who's a senior at Matilla Valley, Tony Khouri, right there. I know he's going to kill me later, but I had to say hello. And just so you know, Tony runs all of my volunteer high school walking campaign. So anyone who wants to volunteer on a congressional campaign, please see Tony. He's wearing the Khouri for Congress shirt, and I think Ben is with him. But looks good on your resume, and it's a lot of fun. So if you want to volunteer, please see my son, Tony. So I am currently a DuPage County board member and a small business owner here in Aurora, and I live here in Aurora. And I am passionate about helping people. And one of my favorite things I am proud of on the DuPage County Board is I have helped your parents by keeping our taxes low. DuPage County hasn't raised our tax levy in 8 years, so that's more money they have in their pocket to spend on you. I'm also very proud of helping unemployed and underemployed individuals. So I started an initiative called the Metro West Manufacturing Collective. And what this does is we partner with two other organizations and we recruit and train unemployed and underemployed individuals, and then we place them in full-time employment in the manufacturing field. But the best part of this story is the first two graduates from this program came from DuPage PADS, our local homeless shelter. These two individuals were homeless a year ago and they're now fully employed in manufacturing. So jobs change people's lives. I've seen it. So I'm all about jobs, and not just jobs, good paying jobs. And that's how I want to help you, because you are our future. Now, when I graduated high school in 1987, we had two choices. You either go to college or you learn a trade. And either option got you a good paying job to take care of yourself and your family. Unfortunately, you all are faced with two different choices. You either go to college and get mounted up with debt, or you get a low-skill, low-paying job. This is unacceptable to me. I want to change that. We need to make college more affordable, number one. And if you don't want to go to college, which not everyone is meant to go to college, I want to promote workforce training to help people learn a trade so, again, you can get not just jobs, but good-paying jobs. So those are some of the things I want to focus on in the U.S. Congress. So I'm running for the federal level, so I want to represent you in Washington, D.C. And we need more people in Washington that just care about our community and care about the people in it. I want to help our Latino population by passing real immigration reform. You know, these politicians have been talking about immigration reform for 30 years, and they haven't been able to get it done. I want to get that done. So it is my pleasure to be here. I welcome the any questions that you might have.
Ms. Curry, if you're in control of our nation's budget, would you increase or cut back on defense spending in our military?
Well, I am a big believer of everything is a balance, right? So right now we have $19 trillion in debt, so we're definitely out of balance. We need to increase the revenue, which has to be done growing our economy. We have a 1.2% GDP right now. We need to grow our economy, and I'm a big believer that that has to be done through the private sector. So there's a lot of differences between my opponent and myself, but here's the biggest difference. My opponent uses every opportunity he can to grow our government and raise our taxes. I fundamentally disagree with that. We are the greatest nation on earth, not because of our government programs, but because of our free enterprise system. Think about it. Everyone wants to move to America, right? My husband is an immigrant. So everyone wants to move to America. Why? Because they know that we are the land of opportunity, and we have to remain the land of opportunity for everyone, no matter where you live. Now, everyone deserves the opportunity. It's up to you what you do with that opportunity, but everyone deserves the opportunity to succeed, and that has to be done through the private sector.
Ms. Khouri, who is your favorite president of all time and why?
Well, I don't want to copy my friend Janice Anderson, but you know, I liked Ronald Reagan for many reasons, but he was inspiring. You know, we're at a time right now, we all feel it. There's division in this country like never before. We need a leader that inspires us. Never underestimate real, true hope, real, true patriotism, that we are all Americans. We need to stop this division among us. So, because of inspiring and unity.
Okay, here's a question from the social media hashtag. Can you name one issue where you disagree with Donald Trump, and then also, how can you support the law and order candidate Trump while illegally taking homeowner tax exemptions?
I didn't hear the last part of that.
The second part is, how can you support law and order candidate Trump while illegally taking homeowner tax exemptions?
So there are some things I agree with Donald Trump. There's a lot of things I disagree with. Immigration is number one. I believe in earned legal status. I believe people should have the opportunity to get right with the law. And it's a shared responsibility between our federal government and the people who came into this country. So this situation that we are in right now in the Middle East is very unique. We have never dealt with this situation before. And part of the reason why we got here was the lack of leadership in Washington right now that gave the rise to ISIS, that now 4 million people are without a home. Now, my husband is from the Middle East. He's Lebanese Christian, so I understand that mindset. They don't live the way we do, that we move around from state to state. Their families have lived there for centuries. So I support the countries that are taking refugees right now to support them financially, so when this crisis is over, they can go back home. I mean, they deserve to be able to go back home.
Okay, we'll do one last one from the social media. What are your thoughts on international intervention and foreign military aid?
I think the world is a safer place when America is the leading power. I believe in peace through strength. We're dealing with issues now that we have never dealt with before. Because of the lack of leadership, again, with this administration, we have wars going on all over. Libya, Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria. We need leadership. So I will work closely with the Department of Defense to review what our options are. But I want to make sure that we come up with a plan that has two things: specific timelines and specific benchmarks, so we can monitor and see our progress in this war on terror. That's it.
Okay, you have 1 minute for a closing statement.
Great. Thank you so much again for coming here. I do want to point out that my opponent is not here. And I don't know if he has a surrogate, but they'll probably say he had another event. I had another event. I left early to come and be here with you because you are that important. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Khouri, and good luck. We next welcome Ben Huntley, a surrogate for Congressman Bill Foster, who had a previous commitment and could not be here tonight. Foster is the incumbent representative for our 11th Congressional District. Congressman Foster's campaign is represented tonight by Ben Huntley.
Hi, everybody. I'm Ben Huntley. I am the Congressman's campaign manager. He's very sorry that he couldn't be here tonight, but he did want me to express how excited he is that you all are getting involved in the political process so early. For those of you who don't know Bill, he is a scientist, he's a congressman, and he currently, a scientist and a businessman, and he currently represents the Illinois 11th Congressional District in D.C. The 11th Congressional District runs from Aurora down to Joliet, through Naperville, Downers Grove, Lyle, into Burr Ridge, Romeoville, Bolingbrook, Plainfield. I've been with the congressman for about 5 years now, and I know firsthand how honored he is to represent the Illinois 11th in D.C. You know, he is the only PhD scientist in Congress. So he brings a very unique perspective to Washington. Bill attended the University of Wisconsin, where he studied physics. And when he was 19, he and his brother actually started a theater lighting company with a $500 loan from their parents. That company now manufactures about half of the theater lighting in this entire country. That includes Broadway, touring rock and roll, community theaters. Some of his lights may even be in this auditorium. That company provides more than 800 good high-tech manufacturing jobs with good pay and good benefits. He has kept those jobs here in the Midwest, which he's extremely proud of, because he understands the importance of providing good paying jobs for the middle class. Bill then went to Harvard to get his PhD in physics, where he became a scientist. Where he actually worked for 23 years at Fermi National Accelerator Lab up in Batavia, performing experiments and solving some of the toughest challenges in science, and leading teams that helped build the giant particle accelerators, and obviously went on to lead the teams that made some of the greatest scientific discoveries that man has ever seen, including the discovery of the top quark, which is actually the heaviest known form of matter. So you all are probably asking yourself, theater lighting, successful career in science, why politics? I've actually asked him that question myself. He informed me that his dad was a chemist, actually, who served in World War II designing firing control panels. And he would get these reports back every week saying how many people his equipment had killed that week. So after the war, Bill's father actually decided to become he went back to law school and decided to become a civil rights lawyer, where he actually helped write most of the enforcement language in the Civil Rights Act of 1964. It was actually after his dad died that Bill was reading through his father's journals, when he started to think about how much time one should spend in service to their fellow man. So he likes to say that he fell prey to his family's recessive gene of adult onset political activism. Bill then decided to run against ex-Speaker of the House, Dennis Hastert, in the old 14th District, 14th Congressional District. Midway through his term, Speaker Hastert quit, which triggered a special election, which Bill was fortunate enough to win. As a member of Congress, Bill actually took office during the depths of the financial collapse in 2008. The families and businesses in our district and all around the country, frankly, are just now recovering from. You know, during the Great Recession, households lost about $13 trillion. You know, Bill was there for the collapse and subsequent legislative response to help rescue our economy. As a member of the House Financial Services Committee, Bill became deeply involved in both the emergency intervention to rescue our economy, the automobile industry, the housing industry, and to stabilize our financial system. And the subsequent legislative response, the Wall Street Reform and Consumer Protection Act, more commonly known as Dodd-Frank. These were difficult votes that divided his constituents, but were necessary in order to save the economy and to make sure that families in America never had to go through the sort of disaster again. He was also there for the subsequent regulatory response. In fact, he's very proud to say that he got 10 of 10 of his amendments into the House passed version of Dodd-Frank, and about 6.5 survived the compromise with the Senate. Bill lost in 2010 during the Tea Party wave and returned in 2012. Since returning to Congress, Bill has rejoined the Financial Services Committee and also serves on the House Science Committee, grappling with scientific and technological issues such as climate change, cybersecurity, in an increasingly partisan atmosphere where, unfortunately, scientific fact and logic are often ignored. But after all of that, after that, frankly, quite impressive resume, Bill is most proud of the work he's done for his constituents right here in Illinois. He and his office have gotten legislation passed to address the opioid epidemic. They've returned $1.8 million that were owed to constituents from government agencies, has attended over 300 events across the district, and never shies away from working across the aisle to get things done for Illinois and for the Illinois 11th. As the only PhD scientist of any kind in Congress, Bill feels that he has an extra responsibility to evaluate the technical components of any and all policy and bring a thoughtful and rational voice to Congress. You know, Bill's family background in civil rights is his guidepost on important social issues, where he's been a strong advocate for marriage equality, for equal pay for equal work, a woman's right to choose, and access to birth control, all of which, frankly, are at issue in this election. But, you know, he couldn't do it without support of his constituents and obviously, you know, all of you. So if you are old enough, I urge you to vote on November 8th. If you are not, I hope you do get involved. And thank you all for having me.
Hi, everybody. Thank you all so much for having us out. My name is Claire Ball. I'm running for Comptroller for the state of Illinois. Just a quick word on what the Comptroller does. Comptroller is basically, as Tim Curtin said, the chief financial officer for the state. Well, what that means is they are in charge of the financial reporting and the payment authorization for the state of Illinois. It's basically the accounting job of the state. So I'm a homeowner. I'm a homeowner and I've worked in accounting for 10 years. I'm married to the gentleman with the black hat who talks very, very fast. So for any of you that spoke with him, I can tell you he talks like that all the time. That's not just for you. And we are the proud parents of two cats. So I decided to run the Office of the Comptroller. Why? Because in 197 years, the history of Illinois, we have never had an accountant in the Office of Comptroller. We've had a lot of interesting people in the role. We had someone who even challenged Abraham Lincoln to a duel. But but we've never had anyone with the same qualifications that you would find in the private sector equivalent. And I mean, all you have to do is think about it. If you were to go and try to get a job as a CFO, as a staff accountant, as a senior accountant, anywhere, they'd look at you funny if you didn't have any accounting credentials. So I look at our government funny for that. I'm running because there's not enough accountability in our government. I'm running because we are severely neglecting our accounting, the accounting for our state. And this is our money. This is all of our money. And we should be holding our elected officials accountable to the same standards that we have to follow every day, if not higher. I'm a libertarian, and I think that's a big win when you're talking finances in politics, because I don't care who your father is, and I don't care what letter follows your name. If you're playing games with our money, I'm going to call you out on it. And that's a level of independence that you're not going to see from the two major parties. So I don't want to take up too much time here. I'm going to pass it over to Kent. Like, I haven't been campaigning with you for how many months? Take it away.
Thank you, Claire. Don't feel bad. I have four older brothers, all their names begin with K. So there's Kenneth, Curtis, Keith, Kevin, and Ken. So my parents only got my name right 20% of the time. Again, my name is Kent McMillen, and I'd like to say that I'm a regular guy running for U.S. Senate. I live in Meadows Park. I have a 28-year-old son, a 24-year-old daughter. I'm running because the federal government has gotten too big, and we just don't have enough choices. $19 trillion in debt. 750 employees in the Defense Department who are not in the military. 250 trade offices for the Department of Commerce. We spend nearly $500 billion more a year than we take in. And we take in quite a bit of money. Get a lot of money in the federal income tax. I hear a lot of politicians saying they're going to do all these things for you. They're going to give you free education, $15 an hour minimum wage. Whatever else is out there. Nothing's free, guys. Somebody has to pay for that. And I'm one candidate who is saying the government has gotten too big and we have to make it smaller. And that means cutting programs, cutting departments, and unfortunately letting go of some federal employees. What this will do over the long run, it'll lessen the need for such high taxation, and it'll put more money in everyone's pockets. And I think everyone can agree with me that that's a good thing. So it's great to be here, and bring on the questions.
Questions are for both of you, but would you like to start with a PBS question or an HBO question?
I'm an HBO kind of guy.
Oh,
so
HBO, yeah.
Let's do that.
If you could run for your position in any time in American history, when would you run in order to accomplish your goals?
One more time, I'm sorry.
If you could run for your position in any time in American history, when would you run in order to accomplish your goals?
Okay, since I don't follow a pattern, I guess I would like to run during the Roosevelt years, back in the 30s, because that's when government really took off on its size and the fact that it was encroaching on it. That's when Social Security started, that's when a lot of other things started. And government programs don't always work well, and they just keep getting bigger. So I would be a voice to say enough is enough. You know, we didn't always have a federal income tax. That was voted in by an amendment. I don't know what people were thinking about back then, but obviously they were convinced that that was a good thing. In my opinion, making the government bigger and more intrusive in your lives never was, never is, and never will be a good thing. Your freedom and your prosperity is the most important thing.
Okay, we have a question from the hashtag. Oh, did you want an opportunity to answer? Go ahead. Go for it.
Well, I would pick similar. I really like Herbert Hoover. Because he had this thing called the invisible hand, where government would come in with an invisible hand and only tap where necessary. I don't know much about Coolidge. See, he's still talking to me.
And I like that.
At least he doesn't call me Kurt.
Huh?
At least he doesn't call me Kurt.
We could bring him up here if you guys want. But I like that idea of the invisible hand. The government shouldn't be in your face. It should be poking when necessary, but otherwise letting us do what we want to do.
Okay, now for the question from the hashtag. What steps would you do to decrease gun violence in Chicago, Illinois?
That's easy. You legalize drugs. You take away the black market for drugs, and you take away the power of the people that are controlling this black market. You let other people compete with that, and you take away drug laws that put folks that use drugs in prison. You give them opportunities for treatment. The more people that have drug problems, the more access to treatment they have, the fewer drug users you'll have. The fewer drug users you'll have, the less demand for drugs. The less demand for drugs, the drug price goes down. The drug price goes down, the drug dealers will have to get another job.
Oh, pardon me. Was that question about drugs or guns?
Guns.
Okay. Well, not that the comptroller has any much to say in that way, but as a libertarian, I would say that we need to decrease the rules surrounding gun ownership for citizens, because criminals are not going to follow the laws. And if they think that you are armed, they're going to be less likely to try anything. So, short and sweet for it. But.
Yeah, if I could just add on to that. Again, most of the illegal guns and the dying that's happened by guns is due to the drug war. So that's why I was talking about the guns. Mm-hmm.
Final question. What is your stance on the stagnation in the Senate's decision to hear Justice Garland's Supreme Court appointment case? What is your stance on the stagnation in the Senate's decision to hear Justice Merrick Garland's Supreme Court appointment?
Okay. That's a national disgrace. Justice Scalia died in February. So President Obama would have been in office for almost a year. Where do you draw the line? Is it 18 months, 24 months? We need a full Supreme Court. A lot of decisions have deadlocked, and so they get kicked back to the court that's below the Supreme Court. They should have put it on a fast track, and he should have got an up and down vote as quickly as anyone else should have. And unfortunately, for those that opposed his nomination in the process, if we have a President Hillary Clinton, and if we happen to have a Democratic Senate, they're more than likely going to get a much liberal justice than Justice Garland.
Thank you. You guys have 1 minute for a closing statement.
All right. I'd like to leave you with two things. First is, if anyone here doesn't know what they want to do with their careers, they don't know what they're going to follow in school, one, don't feel bad, because most of us still don't know what we want to do with our lives. But two, get your gen eds done at a community college and then decide where you want to finish up at a four-year, because you will save so much money in the long run. Okay, first and foremost. I was homeschooled through high school, and my first real structured learning was at a community college, so good stuff. Secondly, for those of you who aren't sure where you fall on the political spectrum, look at every option. One of the reasons that you don't see and hear from third-party candidates, from the Libertarians, from the Green Party, from others, from the Constitution Party, is that it's very difficult for us to get the kind of attention that the Republicans and the Democrats get. Political affiliation shouldn't be your only reason to vote a certain way. Look at every candidate. Look at what they want to offer and what they've done in the past. I'm an accountant. I've got over 10 years' experience in accounting and finance.
I'm running for a position that is not legislative. It is an accounting job, and that we've never had an accountant in that role in Illinois. It's surprising, but it's not surprising because it's politics. So just look past party designation and look at the person running. And if you want to check out more information from me, ClaireBallForIllinois.com, and follow me on Twitter, follow me on Facebook, please. Okay.
You all have a big stake in this election, and you have a big stake in the statements and the stances of politicians. Ask the tough questions. You're the future. Ask them tough questions about things like Social Security, the national debt, Medicare. You'll be paying for all this stuff soon. Social Security is on very shaky ground, and I don't hear anybody talking about getting rid of it and letting you guys keep all the money that you make. So check out websites. You're an interest. You're a voting block. You may not be voting now, but you will be. And the issues that are important to people my age, you may have totally different issues. So stay involved and be a good citizen. And be good to each other. Have fun. This is a great time of your life. If you go to college, have a lot of fun.
Don't hurt people and don't take their stuff.
My website is Kent, that's K-E-N-T, the number 4, Senate.com. And that's also my Twitter and my Facebook. Thank you all so much. Have a good night.
Thank you to both candidates, and good luck in your campaigns.
We'd like to remind voters that early voting begins on October 24th at several locations in DuPage County. We are also proud of the number of MCVA students that have signed up to work as election judges in DuPage County's first judge program. We next welcome Stephanie Kifowit, our incumbent representative from Illinois' 84th District.
So, I'm not going to stand behind a stuffed little podium here because I think it's important for you all to know who I am. I am blessed to be the state representative of the 84th District. I have been in that position for approximately 3.5 years, and in that time we have passed a lot of legislation that helps individuals. It is true, in the whole 200-year history of Illinois, we've never had a budget impasse until this governor and at this point in time. And it's been very sad because a lot of programs that helped me go to college are in peril and are suffering because of the fact that individuals cannot get together, individuals in the leadership position, which they deserve to be criticized, and they should be, because we need to come together and get a responsible and fair budget. However, as a state representative, as one person of 117 individuals, I have been able to pass a lot of legislation that helps individuals, that helps family, that helps survivors of domestic violence, that helps students, that also help our schools. In the stopgap budget, the schools are receiving, in this area, $9 million more, and that's so important to our students. For me, my background is I graduated from high school, and I didn't have money for college, and I didn't have opportunities, so I joined the United States Marine Corps. I served 4 years active duty as a female Marine. I went to Camp Pendleton, California, and I traveled all the way to Okinawa, Japan, and Korea. And so I've seen the world, and I've served my country. I came back, and with the help of grants and assistance and my GI Bill, I was able to go to Northern Illinois University, and I was able to get my undergraduate degree, and I was able to get my master's degree. And through those programs, our programs I fight for in the State House, because they are so important to me, and they are so important to you. I stayed home. I was an alderman with the city of Aurora. We helped clean up the east side. Crime is at an all-time low because we need safe environments for our families. for our students, just to live and be happy. And that's the main reason why I'm a state representative, to be here for you, to be here for your families, and to work very hard. I know individuals like to point fingers, they like to play the blame game, they like to look at the situation and just say all the wrong things. The right thing to do is, right now we're in a mess, and we need to stop negative political bantering. We need to stop name calling. We need to roll up our sleeves and get to work and find the solution for the state of Illinois. And I am prepared to do that, because if anybody knows a job can get done, a Marine can do it the best. Thank you very much.
Okay, we're going to start actually with a question from the hashtag. And it is, what issue that your position can influence do you feel is the most important?
The issue that I feel is the most important is, of course, right now our state budget. So we do have a stopgap budget in place that expires on December 30th. And then after that, we need to come together as respectful individuals that I know I am, and some individuals in the State House are not, but we need to come together and find a solution for a responsible, fair, and a budget that meets the needs of our students, our universities, our domestic violence shelters, our kids that are homeless, and our home human services all around, because that's a fair, responsible, balanced budget.
Our next question, what is your stance on nuclear energy?
Nuclear energy? I think we need to do all that we can to have clean energy, and nuclear does not allow for carbon, but we also have to make sure that nuclear energy is at a point where we can be responsible with regards to the waste. Right now, I will tell you, if anybody here remembers the 50 below weather we had, the polar vortex, the only reason why your houses had electricity was because of nuclear energy. It was too cold for coal, it was too cold for natural gas. So we certainly need to make sure that we have energy that's clean, that's reliable, that we have technologies that get rid of the waste, and we also need to invest in clean jobs, wind, solar, and all the rest of the clean portfolio for our energy needs.
Our next question for you is, what would you want your legacy to be? What would you want your legacy to be?
Oh, my legacy. Honestly, not to be depressing, but my legacy is to completely eradicate veteran suicide, which is what I'm working on every day. I think that it is so horrific that individuals come back from serving our country and they are alone and they are depressed and we're not there for them. So I pray every day that I can leave a legacy where those individuals are helped with and they get the services they need. I've also am working really hard, and I pass a law for youth suicide. And whenever anybody takes their lives, it's so devastating to our society, to our families, to our friends. And so that's what I hope my legacy is, to really combat suicide and make people really understand that they're part of a community, they're important, and that we need them here. What are my thoughts? Well, that is a national issue. So on the state level, we don't have any regulatory ability over Planned Parenthood. What I do know is that we need to make sure that individuals get the support that they need, regardless of what situation they need. And if somebody, in the instances of rape or abuse, they need to be able to get services that they need. So I do believe that we need to help individuals, regardless if they're male and female, get the services that they need, get the support that they need, and get the education that they need.
Representative Kifowit, you have 1 minute for a closing statement.
Well, thank you. Thank you for having me. I want to apologize for being late. My son is in robotics. I don't know if any of you are in robotics, but they changed the meeting date from tomorrow to today, so I had to drop him off, and he's a freshman at Oswego East. So we're very excited about that. One of the main things that I just want to say is that I am so blessed to have great volunteers and great people working on my campaign and supporting me in the community. I ran into a second grader today who said that she was happy to be part of my membership. So I thought that was really fun. I have been in the State House, like I said, 3.5 years, not a long period of time, but we have been able to pass good laws that help, like I said, individuals that are victims of rape and abuse, senior fraud, and really done some things that help people's quality of life, and that's the main thing. So I appreciate all the support I can get. My website is just stephaniekifowit.org. You probably saw Nate in the hallway by my signs and my flyers. And I will stay afterwards to answer any questions or concerns and go into more detail if you'd like. Thank you very much.
Good evening, WV. My name's Mike Strick. I've been in 204 for probably 24 years. I was here when Neuqua Valley was built. I was here when Matea Valley was built. And all my kids went to WV. I am so proud to be here and talking in front of you all today. So thank you so much. Guys, I'm a small business owner. I own an oil change shop and I'm a mechanic. And I'm just tired of the way Illinois is going. We're going in the wrong direction in so many ways. Our property taxes are sky high. Manufacturing companies are leaving the state. And people are leaving the state. And once that happens, folks, that burden shifts to us. They tax us more. We're being taxed out of our homes. Our property taxes are unbelievable. If you were to talk to your parents, just ask them when you go home tonight. Hey, Mom, hey, Dad, what are we paying in property taxes? And they're going to say, we're paying too much. We're being taxed out of our homes. The other thing I want to talk about is Michael Madigan. Anybody knows who Mike Madigan is? He has been in office since 1971, 45 years. He's been Speaker of the House for 33 years. Ms. Kifowit has been in office for 3.5 years. She's voted for Mike Madigan to be Speaker of the House. Not once, not twice. And she's going to, and I'm not going to try to make her do it again. So that's why I'm running. And she's also voted for Mike Madigan in the Rules Committee. The Rules Committee, he makes the rules for the House. And those rules are disingenuous to all us taxpayers. Everything goes through Mike Madigan's desk. And Stephanie Kifowit, she has called him his mentor. We need to change. We need a change in Springfield, and I'm the guy that can bring that change to it. Thanks.
Okay, we're going to start with one from the hashtag. Many campaigns promise that they will stick to their values, but as a candidate, how open are you to compromising?
You know, I believe compromise is something big. You know, we do that in our lives every day. Compromise is something that needs to be done. And we just got to get rid of the special interest groups and a lot of the campaign financing that's out there is ridiculous. I'm running my campaign on a shoestring budget, and I'm making a difference in our district. Boy, that's a great question. I've engaged the district. Are we talking about students?
Just individuals.
Okay. Yeah, I've talked to probably 6,000 or 7,000 homes, and the message is clear. You know, people are being taxed out of their homes, and they understand what's going on. And they're like, yeah, as soon as my kids graduate high school or college, I'm leaving. I'm going to a different state. And I say, well, we just need to make some changes in Springfield. That's what we need. We need to bring manufacturing jobs back to the state and give people jobs.
Our next question is also from Twitter. From your potential position, what would your solutions be for the Illinois budget crisis?
Yeah, you know, the budget crisis is a concern of mine. You know, Illinois does not have a revenue problem. We have a spending problem. All of the unfunded mandates that are out there are really hurting the state. I'll give you a good example. Recently, the House passed a bill that required each polling location to have same-day registration. Well, that law became unconstitutional. But you know what? It was an unfunded mandate. And to give you an example, it cost Will County $1.6 million. $1.6 million is what it was, and it was an unfunded mandate. There was no funding for that, and yet the law was passed.
And the last question is going to be, what are your main priorities / targets in your government position?
Yes, I want to mandate a property tax freeze. I want to ensure that our school tax dollars stay in our district and are not sent to Chicago. Chicago and Mike Maddox want the suburbs to pay for the school districts in Chicago. And what I see a problem is that Chicago only taxes their property at 10%. And we tax our property here in the suburbs at 33 1/3. So you might ask yourself, why is that? Well, because they want the rest of the state to pay for their CPS. I don't go for that. We need to keep our own tax dollars here in our district. I want to try to fix our pension crisis. Our pension crisis is $115 billion in the hole. How are we going to come up with that money? Well, Mike Madigan and his team, they want to increase our income taxes to pay for that and bring it down. I want manufacturing jobs to come back to our state. And it'll create so much more revenue for us. We need to be more business friendly here.
Thank you, Mr. Strick. You have 1 minute for a closing statement.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate the League of Women Voters, WV, Matea, and Nikwa for showing up tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a pivotal time for the 84th District and the people of Illinois. We've had one party rule in the House of Representatives for 33 years. Mike Madigan has been in charge of that for 33 years. I want to run to try to dethrone the king of Illinois. He holds up every bill. If he doesn't want the bill to go to the floor, he'll put it in a rules committee. He makes up the rules. I could come up with a cure for cancer and put it in front of Mike Madigan. If Mike Madigan didn't want me or that bill to come to the floor, he would say, no way, it's not going to be done. We need people in Springfield. We need term limits. 45 years for Mike Madigan in office is ridiculous. It only creates corruption, cronyism, and we need change. And Mike Strick, this guy right here, is the guy for you. Thank you so much. I really could use your guys' votes.
Special thanks to all of the candidates and campaign guests. We thank you so much for coming.
While many of you might not be old enough to vote, we hope you can take the time to meet up with some campaigns as you leave. We want you to find out how you can get involved over the next month to help your favorite candidates win and represent your voice on November 8th. Good night.
Thank you all.